Warning, do not listen to this podcast if hearing about freedom and liberty is not legal for you in your community. And if so, you should immediately move to a hipper community.
Welcome to the Freedom FEENS Podcast, a weekly web lab where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi cover the punk rockinist, hip-hopinist current events, as well as timeless universal truths about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because there's no such thing as half-free. The Freedom FEENS Podcast, available from freedomfeens.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
Welcome to the Vaporsmith's Freedom Hour with Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean.
Broadcasting from my windowless bunker.
And Neema Vedadi.
Go, go, Freedom Fiends!
Rolling. So, Neema Vedadi, how you doing?
Doing all right. How you doing, Michael W. Dean?
I am excellent. It's technically episode 50.
Oh, yeah? We should have some balloons and confetti come down and shit like that.
Not so fast. You know why?
Why?
Because there was not an episode 29, so this is really episode 49.
Why was there not an episode 29?
Because that was the first one where we released something else. It was like the, you know, one of the little joke commercials we did for Compliacin or something. And I hadn't really decided yet how to number things. So I numbered that 29 or something. But since then, anything that's not the main weekly episode, we've released with its own numbering. So
next week will be the 50th anniversary of Freedom Fiends.
Next week will be the 50th real Freedom Fiends Neema and Michael chat episode. But actually, if we count all the other stuff, it's like really the 70th episode or something.
Yeah, plus we could get rid of all the stuff that was the Guns and Weed podcast and not count that if you really wanted to be technical.
No, I renumbered those, the first six or seven. The file names say Guns and Weed, but I edited the intros and outros, so they say Freedom Fiends. So those count.
Oh, those count. Okay. Yeah. For those who were late joiners, it used to be called the Guns and Weed podcast. And then Michael wanted to change the name, so we batted around a few ideas. One of the ideas was yakking about freedom. And I was like...
Freedom yak.
Freedom yak. Oh,
right. It'd be a picture of a yak with an anarchy symbol on it. And you hated it, and you're right.
It was a funny idea, though. Maybe we'll do a joke episode where it's Freedom Yak.
And we settled on, or not settled, we picked Freedom Fiends, which is great, but we didn't realize that Fiend is German for fairy, so we're the Freedom Fairies in Germany.
Yes, that'll be our new mascot. Any Germans out there listening, please draw us a fairy with an anarchy symbol on her forehead. Or an anarchy symbol on each... That'd be better.
So you know what this episode's called, Neema Vedadi?
I never do. And then I don't even after you tell me because you always change the name.
Well, I'm not going to change this one. This one's called Mean Old Man Murders Playful Little Boy.
That mean old man. Why did he have to murder that playful little boy, Michael?
I know. It's a reference to an MSNBC headline, which I'm going to link. And it's the headline is Cops, like cops say, Cops. Man, 65, kills teen who knocks him off bicycle, which really comes off as mean old man murders playful little boy. But when you read the article, you find out that it was actually a guy was riding his bike in a remote area in the woods in Pennsylvania, and three, you know, teens, but not like little kids. I mean, we're talking like men.
Right.
Were lying in wait, knocked him off his bike, started beating the crap out of him, and were likely going to kill him or beat him with an inch of his life. And he shot two of them, killing one of them. It was clear-cut self-defense. But MSNBC, as the mainstream media so often does, paints it with, you know, sympathy to the aggressor.
Oh, of course. Unless the aggressor is a cop, and then it's always, you know, the cop did the right thing, or somebody was annoying a cop, so the cop shot him. Well, he was just doing his job, you know?
Yeah. You know, a more accurate headline would have been, old man practices self-defense when assaulted by three thugs in remote area.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's what I'd do if I got knocked off of my bicycle. I'd pull out the jammy and let a few fly.
The jammy. Yeah, the lamestream press doesn't even serve the people anymore. If you check out the comments on that, I mean, there's one or two... what a mean old man type comments, but they're overwhelmingly sane and in support of what he did.
Did the lamestream press ever serve the people, Michael? I mean, maybe before my time, but not in any of my recent memory. Can I remember them being anything but lapdogs for the state or the status quo?
It never served the people, but before the internet, everyone believed it served the people. And now, I mean, just the fact that you can comment on articles, and they used to kind of moderate them more, but they kind of don't much anymore.
Right. I love the comments section on any article. That's always one of my favorite places to read. And I always thought, you know, part of the way mainstream news works is you create a package, you have to go get, you know, real people, you know, people to comment on whatever the situation is. If the government's making a new law, you have to go find random people who are affected by it to comment. And that's so obsolete these days, because you have 50 to 100 people on every news story commenting, real people who don't feel nervous because they're on camera, so they can actually let their true feelings be voiced.
Yep. The comment I posted on that site was, the only reason these thugs probably knew about this remote trail was some state-sponsored, tax-funded, take an inner-city youth to nature retreat program.
Right, right. It was a field trip.
Yep.
They let him have a little time off the plantation to go.
Well, they probably took him there on a field trip, and the guys probably said, hey, let's come back here next weekend and mug one of these old people on a bicycle.
Did they have the old guy commenting at all in the article? I'm sure they didn't.
Of course not. No. An interesting comment I had from a friend was, and this is like, you know, a young hip guy about your age. He said, the victim was 65 from a different era. Currently, I don't think as many people carry guns or are familiar with guns. Or am I wrong? And he said, stories like these will decline in time. And I said, you're absolutely wrong. Gun ownership is at an all-time high. So is issuance of concealed carry permits. When this guy was a young man, there was no way for citizens to legally conceal carry a gun. Now, in a majority of states, any adult with no criminal record can take a class and get a permit. And I linked a map that explains the growth of concealed carry permit shall issue issuance, which I'll link on the site, and link this site called The Armed Citizen. It hasn't updated in a while, but for a while it was reporting every story it could get, whether the news covered it or not, of a citizen using a gun in self-defense, which is woefully underrepresented in the mainstream media.
Right, right. There was a story I read about a week ago of a guy just sitting in the Waffle House, and then two teens tried to rob the place. And the guy didn't really pull his gun out yet until they started pointing their weapons, the robbers started pointing their weapons at the crowd or the customers, and then he soundly shot one of them and killed them. And I thought that was reported well by whatever mainstream outlet did it. I don't recall which one. But every now and then, usually it's the local affiliates will get it right every now and then on this kind of thing.
And occasionally, the mainstream media will cover it if it's either an old lady or a hot young woman.
Right, right. Then it gets a lot more play, yeah. And they have to be white, too. It has to be a white lady.
Yeah,
right.
And when it's the hot young woman, they still, like, totally screw it up and call her a pistol-packing mama and get her to pose with the shotgun and the telephone.
Yeah, yeah. Although, I can't blame them for having her pose. I mean, I guess I can blame them because that's just the way it works.
Well, you always want an image with a headline.
Exactly.
And that's news 101.
Exactly. Exactly. So, yeah. I mean, it's the format that I blame there, not the people themselves necessarily for that decision.
Yep. So, yeah.
Yeah.
We had an unintended accidental additional endorsement for Vaporsmiths in the last episode.
We got
a few people complaining. Here's one of the emails we got. One thing I'd like to suggest, mute or quit sucking on the Vaporsmiths every time you stop taking a breath, please. The high-pitched, wheezy mouth sound drove me crazy enough to stop listening at the halfway mark of episode 49. I always look forward to your podcast, so don't take this the wrong way. It's probably just me, but it definitely made me cringe after the fifth or sixth time. So, Neema and I are making a conscious effort to lean way off mic when we suck.
Right.
Now.
It's just my Vaporsmith's just way out of reach right now. It's like taunting me. I want to grab it and start puffing, but I'm restraining myself for you, the fiend, as my favor to you.
Is that really an endorsement for Vaporsmiths, though? They were saying they don't like the sound of it.
The endorsement is the fact that we're such fiends for them that we just suck them through the whole podcast.
Okay.
I think.
Yeah. Yeah, I dig it.
So you were camping this weekend, and you missed the fact, this is the first time you're learning this, freedomfiends.com was down for 21 hours this week.
Oh, why?
It was a Dreamhost issue, and like most sites on Dreamhost were down for 21 hours, and I still endorse Dreamhost. Shit happens, and this 21 hours was like the most downtime I've had combined since I've been on Dreamhost in 2006. If you added up all the downtime I've had since 2006, it would probably not even equal the amount of time we were down that one day.
So what happened? Dreamhost just had a server crash or multiple servers crash?
Nah, they had an issue where they did a software update without checking it first on everybody's servers. Apache, which is the Linux server software they use, and it just hosed everybody. And they, for everybody on the shared servers, they could do it automatically, but for the people on VPSs and dedicated servers, we're on a VPS, they had to do each one manually.
Wow. All right. So our apology to the fiends. You didn't get your fix for about 21 hours.
It was good practice for SOPA or whatever comes after SOPA, you know, and I think it's all the more reason that people should be downloading all our episodes. And another thing they should do is go to the streaming page and bookmark the streaming link, not on Freedom Fiends, but the link that's on there, because that's on a different server company. You know, you could have, I mean, I actually had like 30 people write me or Facebook me, which is a quality problem. I was kind of feeling bugged, but my friend put it well. He said, quit complaining. If my websites went down, nobody would notice. You know, it's a good thing that people are complaining.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
it's a quality problem, I guess, if people actually notice.
People were actually jonesing for the fiends. So, you know, you could have been over at the streaming server listening to 24/7 back casts.
Which is always nice. It's always nice to get caught up on your Freedom Fiends. You know, because it's kind of like we do a cast and it's out in the air. It doesn't just disappear, though. Go listen to streaming. Go listen to back episodes. You know, you should never have to be without your Freedom Fiend fix.
And I just paid the streaming server for a year, so it will be there for a while.
Awesome.
So, Neiman, did you see this headline on the Huffington Post, of all places? Welfare drug testing bill withdrawn after amended to include testing lawmakers.
No, but I love it. So the lawmakers tucked their tail between their legs when they figured they'd have to get their own drug testing done, huh?
Yep. I think that's a way to kill every bill, is just include the lawmakers in it. You know, I mean, think about the healthcare bill. Like, the senators and congressmen voting on that aren't going to have to use the ghetto welfare, every one-size-fits-all healthcare system. They're going to have the senatorial and congressional healthcare system.
Of course, and the Congress critters never send their kids to public schools. Their kids don't go to the Army. None of those programs
Weren't there like two? I mean, I remember Michael Moore, you know, was in one of his movies, is standing outside Congress, which, you know, a stop clock is right twice a day. Occasionally he gets it right, and it's funny, and it's good. And he was trying to get Congress.
He's a good showman. He's got some showmanship. He knows how to tell a story, and he knows how to itch certain crazy cat spots on everybody.
Yeah, and I think there's something like two or three congressmen whose children are in active duty overseas, which they kind of made fun of in Arrested Development, where a Michael Moore lookalike tries to get the mother to sign up her son, Buster, and she looks at Buster and goes, okay, and signs him up.
And then he has to go to Army. Mm-hmm. He gets his hand bitten off by a seal.
Yes.
Yes.
By a loose seal.
A loose seal. Yes.
So there's new episodes coming out of Arrested Development being produced by Netflix, and they're Netflix only.
Yeah, and I think that's awesome. I mean, it kind of bums me out because I don't have Netflix, but maybe I'll have to get it just for this. But I like that they're taking a new take on this whole model and starting to produce their own shows and picking up one that, you know, everybody loves. Everybody loved Arrested Development, and the old dinosaur of Fox, for some reason, decided to cancel it.
FreedomFeeds.com. freedom beans. Freedom beans. Freedom beans. Freedom beans.
Yeah, that happens a lot with, like, shows that have, I mean, shows that have a cult following, like Firefly, that got canceled, and there was an insane amount of, or just really proactive people trying to get them to continue it. The same thing with that show Jericho, which had a really select audience on CBS or NBC.
Right. You know,
the one that's, like, looks like it was written by someone who's a Boston Tea Party fan. I mean, it's basically the shit hits the fan, and armed citizens protect their neighbors, and they work together without the government, and FEMA is the enemy. And the people who've stockpiled stuff are the people who survive. It begins with a nuclear bomb hitting Denver, and the last episode ends with them, you know, putting a Don't Tread on Me flag up a flagpole and saluting it.
Right. Well, the thing with networks is they always go for the lowest common denominator. So you have something like Arrested Development or Jericho or even Community now on NBC, which, like, everybody my age loves. Like, that's the favorite show of everybody my age, pretty much, or a lot of them. And they put it on hiatus just because it's not a lowest common denominator thing that's not going to get, you know, the biggest pull. But, you know, there's something to be said for niche audiences and cult followings and people who are still going to pay you and still want to consume your product. And that's why I think something like Netflix picking up Arrested Development sets a great precedent for, yeah, for a media company deciding, hey, people are willing to pay for this. People love it. Let's give the people what they want. I think that's a great market solution.
I think that's going to be a killer app for them. You know, killer app is the term for an application, a software product that people buy the hardware to run the software. Like, for instance, desktop publishing 20 years ago. You know, like, if you wanted to start your own newspaper or newsletter, you had to buy Quark and you had to buy a Mac to run it. The same thing with editing video. You know, originally, you had to buy a Mac to run Premiere, which was the only, or not Premiere,
Final Cut,
yep, which was the only real consumer video editing package at the time. And podcasting kind of drove people originally to buy iPods, was one. Even going before page layout, desktop publishing, you know, spreadsheets were made people buy computers, like the first DOS IBM computers. People went out and spent $4,000 on something that your cell phone has way more power than now. But companies had to get them because it saved them money because they could run spreadsheets on them. And word processing was another one. I think that Arrested Development is going to be a killer app in a way for Netflix. Like you said it yourself just now. You said, well, maybe I'll have to get Netflix.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. And I will. And, you know, right now we do Hulu Plus. So we pay like $8 a month and we get to watch everything on Hulu, a lot of stuff without commercials. And it's great. You know, I don't have to spend $100 with a freaking cable company to get a bunch of channels I'm not going to watch. I get to choose what I'm watching.
Yep.
And paying another $8 or whatever Netflix costs now, still, I'm winning out. I'm getting all the content I need for a lot cheaper than paying Comcast or Charter or whoever.
Yeah. I really think I've been gleefully predicting for about 10 years that people like Warner Brothers are just going to be the dinosaur thrashing in the tar pits, dying.
Yeah, well, what do you think SOPA is? What do you think SOPA and PEEPA are? That's the dinosaur thrashing in the tar pit. And, you know, everybody keeps saying in the Liberty Movement, something's going to come after SOPA. You know, don't let your guard down. Don't rest on your laurels. And they're probably right, but eventually that dinosaur is going to drown. I'm always optimistic.
You know, and originally when I first started feeling that way, part of it was just bitterness and revenge because I was in a band that was on Warner Brothers and they and everyone I knew was promising I was going to be a big rock star and then they dropped us. So fuck them.
Fuck them.
But, you know, if I'd been a rock star, I'd be dead by now. So
would you?
Yes.
You think you would have OD'd on heroin or something?
Mm-hmm. Yep. With four hot chicks and a tranny hooker in my bed.
Why the tranny hooker? By mistake or just to be a rock star?
Just to be a rock star. Just because, you know, I'm open to everything. Speaking of which, let's talk about Freddie Mercury.
Freddie Mercury was not a tranny, Michael. But he would have had a tranny hooker in his bed.
He was open to everything. He was very bisexual and leaning towards gay, but he liked women too. You know, he doubles your chance for groupies, basically.
There you go. There you go.
And, you know, he was kind of the first big star to die of AIDS too. So he was kind of a poster child for dying of AIDS, I guess. I don't know. I really like Queen.
Yeah, right. There'd be no Eazy-E without Freddie Mercury.
There you go. I want to correct something. I said formerly that, or I said on a cast a while back that he was Arab. He was not. It's a lot more complicated than that. He was actually Parsi.
Parsi.
Which has relations to your roots, and you didn't even know what it was. I had to explain it to you from reading Wikipedia. What's Parsi?
It rang a few bells in my head because, you know, Parse, you know, sometimes that's shorthand for Farsi stuff. But you were telling me that Parsi is, I guess, of Iranian Zoroastrian heritage that migrated to some region of India because they were being persecuted by early Muslims.
Yep. And then the lineage of it, the DNA of it, got so mixed from intermarrying in India that it's no longer considered a genetic label. It is a religious and ethnic label.
Hmm. So what's the difference between genetic and ethnic then? I thought they were pretty much in the same
boat. Well, for instance, if I converted to Judaism, I'd be a Jew, but I wouldn't be...
But you wouldn't be an ethnic Jew. You'd be a religious Jew.
Right.
Hmm. Freddie Mercury confusing us again.
Yes. Well, you know, he was a pretty confusing rock star, but...
He was a dope rock star, though. I love Queen.
But he was not confused. He was very sure of what he was doing, I'm positive. Except then there's that song, Mustafa, which I remember hearing it when I was a kid. It's a prayer to Allah, and it's a very strange song. I'll put two videos in the podcast blog. One is for Queen's version of Mustafa, and one is for a cover by a metal band called Wolf Spider from Poland, who kind of sound like Death Clock.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I really liked Mustafa. I hadn't heard it until you played it for me. And basically, he sort of like starts off like he's calling to prayer, you know, from the top of a minaret. And then it starts rocking. But still, there's sort of that cadence or that melody still to it. And so it sounds really cool. It's like he's a gay imam from the 70s.
Yeah. Oh, boy. What? So
we're gonna get suicide bomb. We're not going to get drone this episode. I mean, we're going to get suicide bomb.
Between these comments and the last one, we were talking about how the 9/11 bombers smelled. You know, I don't know if the government's going to be our worst problem here.
We want everybody to blow us up.
They probably want to blow you up before me because I'm a white devil. So
you're an infidel,
me,
right?
But you're an apostate because, you know, you have the blood in you. You should be Muslim.
Yeah. I guess technically I'm considered a dual citizen in Iran, at least. I mean, not in America. But if your father was born in Iran, you're supposed to be still an Iranian citizen. At least that's what my dad tells me. And he always uses that as an excuse to not take me to Iran. He's like, no, they'll throw you in the military if we go visit our family.
Yeah. I wouldn't rush to claim your dual citizenship there.
No, I would never try to
claim it.
I don't
see many advantages to that.
I don't want to be a citizen of any state or government, obviously.
And they probably would throw you in the military.
I don't know. Maybe I'm too old for that now. I'm 27. I'm going to be 28 soon. So
I don't know, man. I can think of a whole bunch of problems of you going to Iran.
See, how f***ed up is that? I mean, no matter where I go, some state is going to be with me. If I'm in America, they're going to steal all my money. If I want to go visit my fucking family and see my roots, they're going to throw me in the goddamn military and make me a slave.
Although if you went to Iran and they heard you on Freedom Fiends criticizing America, they might kidnap you and make you be on state TV and be like the Russia Today.
Well, Iran actually has their own version of Russia Today called Press TV. And you'll see it every now and then. They'll do a pretty good piece of journalism, sort of like the way Russia Today often does a good piece of journalism, at least to us Westerners, because it actually criticizes and takes the bureaucrats in America to task. They're not going to take Ahmadinejad to task and just like Russia.
And they're not going to talk about how they're jailing bloggers, and they wouldn't let you talk about how all governments are evil, just America.
Exactly, which would be the problem.
They wouldn't be down with your plan, man.
No, not at all. And that's a good point you bring up too. Anarchy, I think it needs more worldwide global appeal. It's just now starting to really gain traction. I think our brand of liberty is really growing here in America, at least, and in other countries too. You know, there's Mises Institutes in places like Brazil, but in like the Muslim world and in other places, you know,
they fucking kill you.
The Asian world, right? But I think this needs to be a global, worldwide movement. I mean, if we're going to abolish all states, we have to do just that. We can't have anarchy in America and still have a giant super state in China and a giant state in Japan.
So you're saying we have to be like America and push our way of life on the world. All right.
No, see.
And now, some corporate whoring for one of our favorite products.
Hi, I'm Neema Vedadi from the Freedom Fiends podcast, and I'm excited about Vaporsmith's electronic cigarettes. I dig the taste, and I dig the freedom to vape anywhere the nanny staters would wet their pants if I smoked.
Howdy, I'm Michael Dean of the Freedom Fiends, and I love Vaporsmith's. I smoked 3 packs of tobacco cigarettes a day for decades, but now I'm only using Vaporsmith's. I love the flavors, I don't smell like smoke, and I save money, so I have more to spend on ammo and treats for my kiddies.
Vaporsmith's e-cigs revolutionize nicotine ingestion by bringing it into the 21st century. With Vaporsmith's, you'll enjoy all the invigorating nicotine with none of the nasty smoke. Vaporsmith's are clean, efficient, and tasty. Available in 4 strengths and 10 delicious flavors. Reds, classics, Turkish, menthol, strawberry, cherry, vanilla, coffee, minty mint, and cloves. Go to Vaporsmiths.com. Use coupon code FREEDOMFIEND to get 25% off your order. This is a limited time offer. Vaporsmiths.com is run by a liberty-loving entrepreneur, not some subsidized tax-eater conglomerate. Vaporsmiths at Vaporsmiths.com. Vaporsmiths. I'm enjoying one right now. Freedom Fiends, anti-war, pro-gun. New show on the Micro Effect Radio Network, Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi's fun and feisty weekly chat about constitutional, libertarian, minarchist, and anarchist issues, abuse of authority by police, the war on drugs, the war on guns, self-defense, states' rights, natural rights, Austrian economics, DIY art, low-budget filmmaking, digital recording, activism, rock and roll, and more. Freedom Fiends. Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Learn more about The Micro Effect at themicroeffect.com.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network. A collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
6 drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
I'm not saying, no, that we need to spread democracy by the sword or anything like that, like the American government, or like the Soviets wanted to do a worldwide global revolution. It needs to be peaceful, just like anarchy is. It needs to be based on the non-aggression principle. I think it's just the battle of ideas, like we've said so many times before in this cast. But really, it needs to be a global thing. And I don't know. I guess I'm a lot of talk here because I'm not writing books in Farsi and sending them to my relatives there. But I do know that whenever I talk to a lot of my...
I saw you write a word in Farsi. It took you a half hour once.
I was trying to make it look pretty. But a lot of people I talk to, and this is just my personal experience, so I don't know if there's some anarcho-capitalists in Iran or in Saudi Arabia or anywhere in the Middle East, let us know. We'd love to hear it. But, you know, I feel like when I talk to people from Iran, they don't really... It doesn't click for them. They think it's either socialism or fascism. It's either left or right. That's all they can really understand.
We do get downloads from some of those countries really occasionally. And I don't know what's bringing them there.
It could be a visitor, you know, though. It could be some libertarian billionaire on business.
Yeah.
You know, we don't know.
Or it could be just someone who's like searching Guns and Weed or something. you know, both, you know, weed would get you killed in most of those countries too. The thing is, when countries are so oppressive to the point where they give you 10 years hard labor for a tweet, democracy looks like a good deal. And socialism even looks like a good deal. It's a few steps up on the freedom ladder.
Right, right.
So they can't even comprehend. I mean, think about how many Americans can't even comprehend smaller government, let alone no government. And it's much less of a stretch in America to go from, let's cut the government in half from what we have now. Like, a lot of people can't even wrap their head around that. How much more of a leap is it for someone in a country where they jail you for 10 years hard labor for a tweet criticizing the government to consider no government?
Why wouldn't it be easier? Because yeah, the government is so much more evil in those governments. You could just...
Yeah, it's a lot easier to see the evil of the government there. Although, might be harder because you're more brainwashed, you know? I mean, look at the footage coming out of North Korea when their benevolent leader died and there were people weeping in the streets. Although, there is some indication that some of those people were weeping at gunpoint and the people that didn't weep hard enough were dragged off to hard labor.
Right, right. Well, my impression is... In a lot of places that are oppressive like that, like from what I've heard from Iran, it's a lot of people who just, they blow the government off. You know, Iran may be more tyrannical on paper than America, but their government's much less powerful. They're much less rich. They can't afford to have cops on every corner. They can't afford to have the morality police everywhere. So people still have liquor parties. They still have wine parties in their houses. They ignore the government more.
They just don't tweet about
it
afterwards.
They just don't tweet about it, right.
They don't post pictures on Facebook.
Exactly, exactly. Which I think is a good starting point. You know, here in America, we tend to think, well, we are the government. If you have a problem with the government, then just vote and everything will be okay.
I mean, I think freedom starts in the living room.
Yeah, freedom starts in your mind. And then its next extension is the living room. But I think that that's where freedom lives. You know, I think you can lock somebody's body up, but you can't lock their mind. If you're free in your soul and in your heart and in your mind, then that's really the first step.
Think about how liquor prohibition ended in America. It didn't. People were marching in the streets, protesting it, and people were trying to get the government to deal with it. But really, ultimately, the reason it got repealed was people just ignored it.
Right.
I mean, a lot of people went to jail and a lot of people got killed, but it was like people just had liquor parties in their living room.
Yeah, they just stopped giving a f***. And I think that that's how we get rid of the state. We just ignore it. You know, it's like Larkin said, if we could get enough people to just ignore the IRS, what power would they really have? They get their money from us. If we stop paying them, how would they afford enough people to come steal our money? They could print it, but only for so long, right?
You know, there was a... This is kind of unrelated, but kind of related. What you're saying is making me think about the Occupy Wall Street thing, of thinking about the futility of it. It's like, I totally understand what's behind it, but it's like, Stefan Molyneux pointed it out really well. You know, 2,500 people have been jailed, a lot of them beaten or shot with rubber bullets. No bankers have been jailed, and nothing's changed.
But that's not ignoring it. Getting out in the streets and not going to work to camp out and hold a bunch of signs and yell. I mean, that's not really ignoring the state. That's not really ignoring Wall Street. That's throwing a temper tantrum. Let's be grown-ups here.
You know, there was a news article that I can't believe I missed this. I was wondering if you saw this. A few months ago, at an Occupy Burlington, Vermont encampment, some military vet, young military vet that was part of the protest, shot and killed himself in one of the tents.
Oh,
did you hear about that?
No, I didn't hear about that. What?
I think it did not get covered because they didn't want to make a martyr out of him.
That's possible. Well, I mean,
that's kind
did
of
he leave a
news,
note?
You know?
Did he?
No, he was just really frustrated with the whole thing, and he just went into his tent and shot himself and died on the way to the hospital.
Well, I mean, isn't veteran suicides a very, unfortunately, more and more common thing these days?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's hard to tell what the causation
is. It could have nothing to do with, who knows?
Yeah, who knows?
So I saw an article. It's been going around a lot. It's on Raw Story and it's on Reason and a thousand other places. The headline is Active Duty Cop. The war on drugs is a war on people. Where does that line sound familiar from?
We must have mentioned it in our movie, but I might have heard it somewhere else before, too.
No, DJ wrote that line.
DJ wrote it.
And it's in our movie, exactly word for word for that. The war on drugs is a war on people.
The war on drugs is a war on people. It's a war on your daughters, your sons, your neighbors, your friends. It's a war on freedom and a war on those who would defend your freedom.
It's near the beginning of the movie, right after we're talking to the vet who's on medical marijuana, the Marine vet who was injured in the helicopter accident.
Right.
You know, I'm not saying we're owed something for this. I'm kind of saying, like, isn't this cool? I mean, I think that a cop saw our movie. He doesn't want to be named. It's an anonymous interview. Mm. And we know a couple people who have sent the movie to relatives who are cops. I'm wondering if it's one of them. Because I looked on Google and did a search by time. And if you go back like a month ago, the only instance of this term on the internet is the transcription of the movie on gunsandweed.com.
Ah, okay. Well, I'll be damned. Way to go, DJ.
Yep.
As a concept, though, I feel like, I don't know if it's been around for a while, but I feel like all the liberty stuff just gets meshed in my head into one organic scream at the state. And so, yeah. To me, it just seems like the war on drugs has always been a war on people. And I feel like once I learn a concept like that in liberty, then it's hard for me to imagine a time when I thought any different.
Not me. I go, well, Reason should at least review our movie.
They never did, huh?
Nope. And all the three main players there, I've sent a copy of the movie, and I've pinged them by email a few times, and they've never written back.
It's because we're too salt of the earth for them. Reason is all Beltway libertarians. They all want to sip their martinis and talk about how they want to have gay sex and be able to marry their gay lover and smoke a bunch of pot, but that's really all they care about. They don't really hate the state. They just want the state to let them do the things they want to do.
Kind of. One of them is like, we need to work through the system for this, but, you know, yeah.
I don't know. That's just always the feeling I got from Reason, that they did, it was more of an academic theorist kind of, well, liberty works better, so we should be of liberty-minded, but not really, the state is evil, the state is wrong. It's, you know, I feel like the way I look at things is we need freedom because it's the only moral situation. It's not a utilitarian thing.
Yeah.
It's, we need to avoid all this violence from this evil entity, this gang of thieves called the state. We need to just forget about them, ignore them, don't give them any credence.
Yeah, and our Alexa ranking is getting so low, which is good. We're getting so popular that I think in about a year we'll just be able to buy Reason and close them down.
I don't know if we need to close them down. I think there's always a great sense of...
We need to hip them
up.
Hip
them up. There you go. There you go. They'll get with the times, maybe. Maybe that's what needs to happen.
You've been out of town, but our Alexa ranking is 354,000 right now.
Oh, are you shitting me?
Nope.
That's dope. Nice. And you were telling me that a lot of libertarian sites seem to be getting more and more popular, at least as far as Alexa rankings go, right?
Yeah, because I've been getting libertarians to install the Alexa toolbar, which if you haven't done already, you should go do. And I've been helping people out. I know that Ben from Bad Quaker Podcast has been posting about how helpful the SEO episodes have been.
Nice. We also need to convince Anonymous to shut down all websites. That's the next step.
Yeah, that'll happen. No, they want to improve government.
I know. And I just don't get it. I don't get it. I don't get why people think that, oh, government's so horrible. Let's make a new government.
Let's make it more efficient.
Let's make it more efficient at fucking us over.
Hey, did you know that Kai, who is the co-host on Bad Quaker, is Bad Quaker's daughter?
Yeah. They mentioned that in the podcast every now and then. And you can kind of tell they've got a familyness about them.
I just thought they were neighbors or something that got along really well.
Really?
That would make more sense to me because I couldn't imagine trying to do anything like that with my dad.
Yeah.
He wouldn't know what a microphone was, and then he'd be like, Sarah Palin is the answer to all our problems. She should be president. I read her book.
You think it'd make an interesting interview, though? It could be you debunking all the dad spam that's in his head.
I don't know. He doesn't even, like, get dad spam or know how to... You know, we actually added that to the glossary. Let me read my description of dad spam. It's a term that DJ came up with, and it's a really great term.
We need a dad spam jingle and read our favorite damn dad spam of the week.
Dad spam. Forwarded crap that old people who can barely use a computer email to everyone they know. Usual topics include heartfelt letter from a dying Marine, proof that Obama is a secret Muslim, things we said in 1955, and danger, you might die if blank. Those are usually easily debunked by a quick look at Snopes.com.
Or a quick look inside your brain.
Yeah. Dad spam is easy to spot. It usually contains lots of capital letters and exclamation points and rows of forward marks from being forwarded again and again by people who don't know that you can remove those marks. It's always CC'd to everyone, never BCC'd. Dad spam is usually sent from an AOL or Yahoo account.
Right.
Michael has a theory that all dad spam originates from a team of paid hacks at some right-wing organization, possibly either Accuracy in Media or the U.S. Chamber of Commerce.
Right, right. I haven't gotten any dad spam lately. What's going on in the dad spamosphere?
The dad spamosphere.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast. Freedom Fiends is now available for 24/7 streaming to your iPhone, Android phone, or other chromed robot turd. Click on the streaming audio link on freedomfiends.com. That's FREEDOMFEENS.com.
You know, the interesting thing about dad spam is it often goes for decades. I mean, literally, like, there's a dad spam I've gotten recently from somebody. It wasn't my dad. It was somebody else that was like, write your congressman. There's a bill in Congress right now where they're trying to put a tax on every email you send. And this is like, this was something that was considered in Congress for a minute in like 1993.
Wow.
And the email is still circulating. And I always write people back when they send it to me and I say, welcome to the internet. Take me off your list.
Nice.
I got a dad spam a while back and it was an urban myth. I looked it up on Snopes. It was not true and it's never been reported anywhere in the country as having happened. But it was like, be careful using payphones because people are going around and putting AIDS-infected needles in the coin return tray on payphones. And I looked at it and I was like, there are still payphones? No, there aren't.
Yeah.
There's no payphones anymore.
I think I've seen like one or two. Like in small towns, every now and then you'll see one or two.
Yeah, so like how long has that been going around? Yeah,
forever. I always get the dad spam it's always sort of attacking the welfare state, but then promoting
the corporate welfare
state.
Yeah,
yeah, it promotes things. It's like, you know, we need to keep our Social Security intact and our Medicaid and our Medicare. And it's like,
yeah.
It's like, we just don't want black people to buy rims with welfare checks. That's the only
yeah.
thing. But we want all that welfare money to go to our pain meds.
Yeah.
Because we're too scared to smoke pot.
You know, I really wouldn't be surprised. I mean, I'm kind of joking saying it's written by paid hacks at Accuracy Media or U.S. Chamber of Commerce, but I think some of it probably is.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, like last cast, we were talking about some dad spam where it was some 12-year-old girl attacking, you know, welfare, saying people need to only be allowed to buy 50-pound bags of rice and beans with their food stamps and on and on and on yeah. and on and on. And that was not written by no 12-year-old girl. That was written by a 60-year-old man.
Yeah, and the heartfelt letter from a dying Marine is debunked on Snopes. It's not written by any real person.
Yeah.
Like, they have the name of the Marine, and somebody looked it up, and like, that guy's never been in the yeah. United States Marines. Yeah. It's bullshit.
Dad spam is probably one of the things on the internet that irks me the most. Because not only are you going to do it anonymously, but you're going to lie about where the origins are. And then you're just going to send it to a bunch of unsuspecting people who don't really understand what the internet is or what media is. It's very disingenuous.
You know, it really seems to me like someone stuck in an old media mindset's reaction to new media. You know, I mean, that kind of stuff existed before, but it was printed as like letters to Reader's Digest, you know?
Okay.
The lefties are more on top of their propaganda. I mean, that leads into this headline, Why Are Globalist Think-Tank Documents Public? And it's a really good article. I'll link it. It's in this site. It's actually on a lot of different sites. I'm going to link it from this site called landdestroyer.blogspot.com, which is all about the UN's march to eliminate us. I'm going to link that one because most of the site that it originally came from has so many pop-up ads that I don't want to link it. But it's basically an article saying that people like the UN and the Brookings Institute and other left-wing globalist, they're not even all left-wing, they're just globalist think tanks mm-hmm. that want to control f***ing everybody in the world. You know, a lot of these are heavily funded privately and by governments and paid attention to by governments. You know, a lot of them have their evil plans on their website. And this is something we've talked about before, is we tend to stay away from the conspiracy theories because we're so horrified that we could barely wrap our heads around the stuff that these people admit on their websites is true. And what this article says is that the reason that they put their agendas out there is because they need the backing of the people that shape the minds, basically professors. And they're often written, they're so long and so densely written that people outside of academia have a hard time understanding them. So they're kind of written in code. But then again, the same people that write these will often go on like Fox News and be experts from the Brookings Institute and explain it in a really dumbed down way that misses a lot of the key points, that just kind of gets Joe Lunchpail and his wife, the Sarah Palin lover, on board to vote for this kind of crap and back.
Well, I mean, that seems completely obvious to me. I mean, that's why they exist, right? That's why think tanks exist, is to push the minds of the gatekeepers or the people who get to be on Fox News and MSNBC. So of course they're going to make these documents public, and nobody who isn't a policy wonk is really going to read it. And anybody who does read it and realizes that this is an evil plan, I guess they're just not scared enough yet. They're not scared enough that those people are going to have enough of a voice to where people are going to stand up against this kind of thing.
I mean, occasionally a smart person finds it and reads it and explains it in a simple way of how horrible it is. You know, the first place I heard about Agenda 21 was on some rural gun nut site.
Right.
Most of the posts on that site were written by people who could not understand the dense legalese that the UN writes in.
Right, right. But of course, the UN's not scared of those people. They just don't have any kind of fear of the average person yet. They think they're on some other kind of level. And we're just the proles. They don't give a shit what the proles think.
I really think that the fact that they have drones now is going to make a big difference. It's literally like, I really think they're going to stop caring that everybody has rifles.
That's a really good point. I'm glad you brought that up. What can you really do against a drone?
Nothing.
A drone you are completely defenseless against.
Nothing, although the Air Force did a test where they did knock one of their own drones out of the sky using a high-powered laser.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Well, where can I get one of those lasers?
I can't. They're licensed.
Exactly.
You cannot buy a 50-kilowatt laser.
I don't know. Maybe we need to all live underground so we can't be droned.
Nor could you afford it. Oh, they're working on bunker busters now that can go 250 feet underground and kill everything. They're working on them to use against Iran.
Because a lot of the facilities they say are so deep underground. Well, what do you think the answer is? I mean, 200 years ago, when the Second Amendment was written, all anybody really had was guns and maybe cannons.
Well, the Second Amendment doesn't just cover guns. I mean, in my reading of it, it covers knives. It covers anything that the government had at the time.
Right, exactly. But that's...
You'll never get away with building a drone, nor would you have the... I mean, I think that's part of the thing, is make them so complicated and expensive. Make the weaponry so complicated and expensive that no citizen could replicate it. And most governments would have trouble replicating it.
So really, it sounds like the only defense, then, against drones is to defund the state.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the defense is education, what we're doing and what other people are doing. You know, I think that the biggest threat to liberty is what I call ParrotPhrasing, which is paraphrasing like a parrot. Just, rah, damn Muslims, rah, army's good, rah, military's good, you know. And, you know, ParrotPhrasing is a good term. It's, you were talking about, like, the way to do well in school was to paraphrase what the teachers were saying. And I thought about that. And actually, the best I ever did in school was when I was paraphrasing the teachers even more eloquently than them, but totally agreeing with what they said. Like, if I could take their words and their bullshit and say it in an even better way, they were like, wow, Michael's so smart. You know?
Yeah, because it makes them feel smart, because you're just saying their ideas.
Parrot phrasing. Yes.
Okay. But the only real defense, then, against the state is to educate people to where they stop buying into it. They'll all withdraw their consent, or enough people will withdraw their consent to where the government can't afford drones anymore. Because we can't fight against drones with bullets, guns, missiles even.
Just our minds.
Just prevent the drones from having somebody who's going to pilot them. Or prevent the drones from having new people that will develop them or maintain them.
And, you know, part of that is horizontal liberation. And I want to read a letter that I wrote to a teacher who wrote to us. Oh, one thing I want to point out is in the last episode, Neema, you said you were talking about having quotes from other liberty people each episode. You said something interesting. You said that we should have quotes from other libertarian rock stars. So does that mean that, in your mind, we have graduated from libertarian garage band to libertarian rock star?
I hope so, but maybe not. I don't know. You always got to aggrandize yourself in some way, right?
Yeah. If you don't believe your own hype, no one else will. That's hip-hop 101. But, you know, I don't think we're quite there yet. I think we're libertarian garage band that tours regionally and draws a lot of people in all the clubs we play, all up and down one seaboard or something. Although we're worldwide.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast. Freedom Fiends is now available for 24/7 streaming to your iPhone, Android phone, or other chromed robot turd. Click on the streaming audio link on freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
So, Neema, what do you think of that cover of Mustafa, the Queen song, covered by the Polish metal band Wolf Spider?
It's awesome. Yeah, it definitely sounds like Death Clock.
I know. It's a lot more manly, actually. The Queen song's kind of fruity.
Well, it's Queen. What do you expect?
Yeah. Although, yeah. Queen kicked ass on about half their songs. About half their songs were I could do without.
I don't know. I always dug Queen. But, yeah, I wasn't like you. I didn't buy their records when they existed or when they were around.
Yeah.
And listen to the whole things the whole way through.
You were not a gleam in your daddy's eye when those records came out.
No, I wasn't. Although my dad had some big old 70s glasses and an afro back in when Freddie Mercury was around.
I'd love to see a picture of that.
I have one somewhere laying around my house.
Cool. Yeah. So I had this exchange. Well, it was kind of a one-way exchange with a teacher. And I want to read this. I think that things like this are really good to do because you get to speak to people outside of preaching in the choir.
Outside of your own libertarian juices.
Yes, outside of your own libertarian pod of friends. I got an email from a public school teacher who's starting a website with resources for other public school teachers, which, and she said,
public school.
And she sent this, what was obviously a form letter that she was obviously sending to a lot of different websites. I think what she was doing was searching education keywords in every website that came up. She didn't look at the website. She just went to the contact page, got the email address, and sent them this form letter offering to do a guest blog post, which is cheesy ass SEO 101. You know, if you go to a lot of SEO, how to do SEO sites, they tell you to do this. It's ridiculous. It's stupid. It's futile. And she didn't even do it right. Because if you're going to do it, you should at least look at the website for 10 seconds to see if they're someone that would want your guest blog post. And you should see if they're even a fucking blog. We're not a blog. We're a podcast, and I said that to her. You know, she wanted to do a guest blog post on Freedom Fiends in exchange for us linking her site, which, you know,
we would never link her site in the first place.
Oh, I would if I were making fun of it, but I'm not gonna. And she has really shitty SEO. Her Alexa ranking's like 23 million with a Google page rank of 0. I sent her this reply. Jan, we do not have guest blog posts. If you look closer, we're not a blog. We're a podcast with radio syndication, and the blog posts are simply show notes of the episode audio. I mean, really, like, if you look at our blog posts, there aren't even complete sentences in them. They're just the topics we talk about.
Yeah, yeah.
And I said, also, we're against all public education. We're more into homeschooling, self-schooling, and alternative education. We consider anything that's paid for by non-voluntary taxation to be parasitic and immoral. Moreover, we consider the current school model to be an anachronism that's outlived any usefulness it once had. There's no reason to make kids show up at the same place at the same time every day, sit in neat little rows, and give them a one-size-fits-all curriculum. That only existed to teach people to work in factories and have an allegiance to a military. Public schools now only exist to teach conformity and blind compliance to authority figures. Any actual useful skills inadvertently learned in a 12-year public education can be learned at home for free in a couple years on Khan Academy. And I linked Khan Academy.
I love learned inadvertently.
Yeah. Since you mainly seem to be looking for backlinks to improve your site's SEO, if you want to reply back, I'd be happy to read your reply on the air and link your site in the show notes of the episode where we read it. Thank you, Michael W. Dean. And she did not write back, which is not surprising. So I'm not going to link her or mention her. But I can only – can you fathom her response when she read this?
I hope she shit a brick.
Yeah.
But maybe she shit a brick and then she started listening to us and realized that she's wasted all her time trying to make public schools better. Because, hey, it's not going to happen, lady.
I think she probably shit a brick, did not look at the website, and just turned us into Department of Homeland Security based on my email.
Right, right. She probably called and said, police, can you please send a drone to Wyoming and Washington State?
I wonder how often people turn me into the DHS or the feds. I mean, I know it's happened at least once because someone's told me they did for a Right Arm of Wyoming song.
Someone told you that they did? Yeah, I think I posted that on
Democracy Now. No, where was it? Democratic Underground.
Yep. That's it. I wonder if they actually did or if they were just talking shit.
Probably just talking shit. You know, they said, just so you know, this has been turned into the federal authorities. And I'm like, you know, first of all, would they say federal authorities if they called it? You know, who do they call?
Yeah, not Ghostbusters.
Yeah, but I think that letter is a good example of taking some time to do some horizontal liberation with someone who would probably never otherwise hear any of it. And I felt completely right in doing it because she was bugging me for bullshit. You know, I'm less likely to do it if I'm in a restaurant and someone at the next table is talking about how great gun control is or something. But I have actually leaned over and not gotten in people's faces, stayed on my table. But
well, she was addressing you. Right. If somebody in a restaurant looked at you and said, why the hell are you open carrying? I don't think anybody should have a gun but the police. I'm sure you would horizontally liberate them, or at least attempt to.
But I've actually been at a table next to someone at another table not talking to me, talking amongst themselves about gun control and how great it is and how we need more of it. And I spoke up, and it didn't end well. They were really f***ing rude to me. And
was this in California or in Wyoming?
Wyoming.
Really? Yep. There's somebody praising gun control in Wyoming?
Well, look at our city council and what they get away with. You know, the state government is mostly Rancher Slater or Christian Sharian right wingers, but the local government of Casper leans socialist and left, and it's a bunch of carpetbaggers from out of state that are trying to, you know, it's horrible. We're getting pulled in two wrong directions in the state.
You guys really are. I don't know. I always thought that the average Joe, though, in Wyoming just doesn't give a shit. And that's why the city council can get away with so much, is because nobody really pays attention.
Yeah, they only pay attention when it's like something they care about, like gun rights or something.
Yeah.
And then it seems like the only people that get involved are the ones that are like,
it's just Anthony Bruchard and that's it.
And, you know, and just unrelated people who are like making threats and stuff, and kind of people that don't want to play the game but want to feel involved.
Yeah, which is really part of the tragedy of even local governments. I mean, the right thing to do, right, is just to ignore the state, to withdraw your consent. But then the state, they don't accept that. You ignoring them, unless enough people ignore them, they're still going to pass their laws. They're still going to think that their laws are valid. So what do we really do other than get everybody on our side?
Other than place a grenade pin on their pillow. Do you know what that is?
Just the pin so they don't know where the hell the grenade is?
That would only work with a Vietnam vet, and I'm not recommending it. I'm just kind of making a joke. Do you know what fragging is?
Is that killing your commanding officer?
Yeah. It was really common in Vietnam. Like, there are over 1,000 commanding officers were believed to have been fragged by their own underlings. Basically, it was a way of dealing with commanding officers that were either incredibly abusive or trying to make themselves heroic by risking the lives of their underlings for stupid missions that didn't help anything. And what they do is, you know, they wouldn't shoot them because you could trace a bullet. They would wait until they were in a firefight with the Vietnamese and then toss a grenade, you know, instead of forward, they'd toss it to the left or the right at their CO 40 feet away, and it was untraceable. And it got to the point where what they were doing was warning people when they were out of line that they might get fragged by putting a grenade pin on their pillow.
Oh, shit. No, I didn't know about that. Yeah, but really, what a crazy situation, because back in Vietnam, people were drafted.
All the time.
I mean, to somebody my age, thinking of that is just unfathomable. I mean, you get kidnapped, basically, and then you get thrown into this jungle thousands of miles from home.
And you have to shoot people that you have no beef with and don't care either way about, because you're going to die if you don't shoot at them, because they're shooting at you.
Exactly. A completely horrible situation where everybody's the bad guy. Your CO is a bad guy, but so is the freaking Viet Cong or Charlie or whoever. I mean, I really feel for the people who got drafted and had to go through that.
And a lot of them came back addicted to heroin because it was the thing to do to kind of deal with it. It was, you know, heroin is incredibly cheap there and, you know, could be bought in town.
Right.
People just smoked it nonstop just to deal with the horror of it.
Right.
Freedom Fiends got your blood boiling? Tell them what's on your mind. Contact them at talkback@freedomfiends.com.
Well, we often talk about American foreign policy and the victims usually being, you know, the brown people that they blow up with the drones. But a lot of times the victims are, at least back then when there was the draft going, the victims were the people who were involuntarily serving and had to go through that because a lot of their lives were just ruined after that. I mean, you probably wake up with nightmares, you have flashbacks. I just can't imagine how horrible your life would be after that.
Well, it was kind of weird how damaged a lot of people came back from Vietnam and how they either weren't in World War II or shrugged it off. I mean, there's actually a King of the Hill episode that kind of deals with this, but it's kind of based on reality. It's where the old farts who have the VFW, which is, you know, Hank's dad, Cotton Hill, and all the other WW2 World War II vets, they can't pay their rent. And Hank suggests getting the Vietnam vets to join the VFW. And they're like, those sissy, Nancy, hippie, pot-smoking commies, no way. And they finally... They have a picnic to meet them and consider it. The Vietnam vets are all like shell shocked. And, you know, when a car backfires, they all duck and start having flashbacks. And, you know, the World War II guys are like, I killed more guys with my bare hands than you. You know, they're just toughed it out kind of. You know, it's like the term post-traumatic stress didn't even exist until probably like Desert Storm. But, you know, a lot of Vietnam vets are still damaged. They have a really high incidence of homelessness. Part of it, too, part of the difference is they were drafted. There was a draft in World War II, but they didn't use it that much. A lot more people signed up in World War II.
Right, right. Well, despite what you think about American history and how we could have avoided getting into World War II and FDR provoking Japan and all that stuff, it was a lot easier to sell to the public back then.
Yeah.
Whereas in Vietnam, I think...
It was more of a threat. I mean, most people hadn't even heard of Vietnam until we went there. Everybody had heard of Germany. You know?
Right, right. Everybody heard of Germany. Everybody had heard of Japan. Yeah.
It was closer and it was bigger.
I don't think people could wrap their heads around why the hell. I can't wrap my head around what.
Basically, the thing that they said was it to stop the spread of communism.
It was going
to
be a domino effect, right? And then all of Southeastern Asia was going to be red.
But really, really what it comes down to, it was a proxy war with Russia.
Right, right, right.
Damn cell phone. Hang on a sec.
Is that the government calling you? Yeah. Telling you to shut the f*** up?
Probably.
F*** them. Even if they celibate.
It's my dad. He probably wants to talk about how great Newt Gingrich is. I actually convinced him to vote for Ron Paul.
You were telling me that. You said you sent him one of the books, right? The Revolution, or was it...
I sent him The Revolution like 3 years ago. And he'd never heard of him, but he really liked the book. He said, you know, this guy knows how to fix America. But he said the same thing about, you know, Sarah Palin. He's a big Sarah Palin fan. I think he has an old man crush on her. But
you know, I'd hit it if I weren't married. I'd totally hit it.
I'd hit it too. But I love saying stuff like that. It just offends so many people on so many levels. But I'd say it if my wife was in the room too. She'd laugh. She'd go, ew.
Oh, my wife knows.
So I sent my dad End the Fed, and he read it, and now he knows who Ron Paul is, and because I've told him that Ron Paul is running for president, he now knows that.
Right.
Yeah.
Because, of course, mainstream media only wants to talk about Gingrich, Newton, Santorum.
It's that lowest common denominator thing again, too. And it's kind of mind-blowing to me because it's like, if you believe in politics, you know, let's put on the minarchist hat for a minute. Let's put on the Republican hat for a minute, which you don't like to do. So I don't know if I'm going to
put that on. I'll just put the hat on my desk and look at it creepily.
Yes, and examine it through a powerful telescope from a distance. But if you are like that, you know, the Republicans you're being offered. Okay, the five people you're being offered.
There's only four now.
But there's Obama. Your choices of who to vote for. Obama or three guys who want to continue ruining America or a guy who's going to save America.
But Newt Gingrich wants to put a base on the moon, Michael.
Yeah, I think he just wants to do that to claim it because all the libertarians want to do that because of Heinlein.
Oh, is that it?
Well, yeah, because it's, you know...
I think he just wants to get that old people vote who look back nostalgically on the moon mission.
Yeah.
But anyway, go on with your thought. I'm sorry.
I mean, it just opens them up for so much hypocrisy and so much ridicule and so much, like... Really? You want to do that and not fix all the problems in America?
Ron Paul's one-liner, though, in response to that was, I don't think we need a base on the moon. We might need to send some politicians there.
I loved it. I loved it. Yep. The Daily Show, they said that that Newt would name Ron Paul his ambassador to Moonlandia. And they showed a picture of, like, Ron Paul's face superimposed on this body of, like, this 50s sci-fi, like, tinfoil suit astronaut.
Nice.
Yeah.
Anyway, you were talking about your only five choices. Okay, Obama, three guys who want to ruin the country even more, and then, of course,
a constitutionalist. The only real constitutionalist. I mean, I've been looking. Read the Wikipedia. People, here's a homework assignment for you. Read the Wikipedia article on neocons. It's pretty interesting. And the other three up there that aren't Ron Paul are all neocons, and Fox News is run by neocons. Neocons originally, interestingly, were...
They're leftists. They were Trotskyites.
They were liberals. It came out during the Nixon administration. One of the nicknames for neocons originally was the Socialists for Nixon Brigade. And yeah, it was basically like this influence on the Republican Party that has become what the Republican Party is. Of, like, yeah. Israel first, massive intervention, military bases all over the world, printing money.
And of course, the noble lie.
Anti-gay marriage. And espousing state rights except where it doesn't suit you. Like, neocons say, oh, state rights, states rights, states rights. But then they want to use federal laws to prevent abortion and to prevent medical marijuana.
The main thing I see with neocons is they think the ends always justifies the means. And for them, the ends is power.
Yeah. And they claim to love the Constitution, but they shred it with every breath that comes out of their mouth.
A neocon will say anything that will get them more power, yeah. No matter what it is. I mean, you'll notice Newt will sometimes give a compliment to Ron Paul, but that's just because he thinks it'll increase his clout with certain people who might vote for Ron Paul.
And it's funny that all of them invoke the ghost of Reagan nonstop. Mm-hmm. And as fucked up as Reagan was, the things he did right that the neocons are invoking, the neocons do not do.
No.
And Ronald Reagan endorsed Ron Paul for his first run as Congress. So he's the only one that's probably ever even met him, let alone was backed by him. And he doesn't bring up the ghost of Reagan all the time like they do.
I think Ron Paul makes a good point in one of his books. I think it was The Foreign Policy of Freedom, where he sort of has a whole chapter tracing back the lineage of the neocons. He takes it as far back as Machiavelli,
yeah.
And says, yeah. You know, when the guy wrote The Prince, the whole thing was about the power of the state and being able to wield that. And in order to do that, you have to tell what's called the noble lie, which is it doesn't matter that the public gets the truth. It only matters that they know enough to go along with you. That way you can increase your power. And that is Neocon 101.
Have you read The Prince?
I've never read The Prince, no.
I've read it. It's one of the two books that a lot of, like, power mogul, power-hungry people read. The other one is The Art of War, mm-hmm. by Sun Tzu.
Yep.
You know, The Art of War is from, like, 3,000 years ago. It's military strategy, and it's unusual military strategy that you wouldn't think of. It's things like...
It's more psychological than
Yeah, it's
tactical.
Things like, you know, letting your enemy advance closer to you so you can get them where they're most vulnerable and letting them think they're winning and things like that. And a lot of businessmen read it as kind of moral support for how to steal more efficiently and how to crush their enemies and their competitors. The Prince was written much more recently. I think it's around 1200 or 1300, maybe even later.
I think it was later. I think it was pre-Renaissance or early Renaissance.
And it was written by a prince who was deposed, who was living in exile. And it was basically his blueprint for how to climb back up to power, and he actually never did, but a lot of people use it as a resource of don't a lot of hip-hoppers like it, a lot of rappers.
I don't know, I mean, Tupac did an album called Machiavelli, but I don't know how much he, I don't know if he read The Prince or was referencing it.
It seems like it would be, you know, it should be popular among rappers.
I mean, I don't dig it, but I'm different.
Well, you know, that's why your rap isn't more popular, because you're not willing to murder your way into a big record deal. You're not willing to hold someone by their ankles out the balcony of a 20-story building and make them sign a contract.
There you go. Yeah, I would never do that.
Pussy.
Hey, I'm not a
pussy.
I'm
kidding. No, you. It's the non-aggression principle.
Exactly. We got to do more than pay lip service to it. You actually have to live it. in order to be a true libertarian?
Worms.
Worms.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends Podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeenS.com.
So, Neema, how square is Romney? Romney is so square.
Dude, he's
that.
He's so square. We were talking about the draft earlier. Get this. Mitt Romney, okay, he actually protested for the draft. When he was 19, he went out and held a sign that he was promoting the draft. Oh my God. I mean, I can't even imagine. And it's funny because in this pic that they took of him holding the sign, this other dude had a sign that said, "Stop anarchy." Right. So, I mean, I don't think any of our listeners out there support Romney, but if for some reason you don't normally listen to us and you decided to give it a try, Mitt Romney wants to enslave you. That's all he cares about.
Neema, I think that anyone who likes Mitt Romney that inadvertently started listening to this episode probably stopped as soon as we were talking about the groovy song by the bisexual singer praising Allah in the first 20 minutes.
That's a very good point. That's a very good point.
Mustafa, Mustafa.
Exactly.
I know. I almost want to cover that with you, but it would involve me learning a lot of notes on the guitar. It's a pretty complicated melody, and I don't feel
well, because it's not the normal Western melody. It's some Middle Eastern scale or something.
Yeah, it's a pseudo Middle Eastern scale, because Middle Eastern and Asian music actually don't use the same notes. They don't use the 12-tone system necessarily. A lot of pop music does, but
right.
Traditional music uses the notes kind of in between our half tones.
I've never figured it out. I've never really given it an effort. Because I've always just heard the music and been like, I have no idea what note that is and don't want to try it.
There are some Western modes, which are types of scales. One's called Mixolydian, one's called Lydian, one's called Ionian, that when you play them on guitar, they kind of sound
like Mixolydian, we actually use that kind of melody in Freedom of Ingestion.
Freedom of Ingestion. Yeah, Mixolydian's the only one that's different going up than down.
Yep. Anyway, we got kind of off topic there. What is our topic again?
Our topic is Romney and how fucking square he is.
So square. So square, I don't even listen
but
to him.
But didn't he avoid the draft somehow, too, even though he's for it?
I imagine he did. Otherwise, he'd be bragging about his military service, which he doesn't.
Isn't Ron Paul the only one
Ron
that
Paul's
served
the only
of those four?
One that served.
I know, and they all want to send other people's sons to die, and they didn't even do it themselves. Ron Paul was a decorated flight
doctor. I almost
doctor.
Want to say I wish Newt, Romney, and Santorum got drafted and went and died.
Got killed.
But if they did, there'd just be some other neocon filling up there saying the same old shit.
Mitt Romney. What's his real name?
Willard
Mitt
Romney. Yeah, good old Willard. I just don't even know anything more to say about him. If you support him, then...
Mitt Romney received a student deferment and then a Mormon missionary ministerial deferment.
Ah, are you looking at the wiki now? Where did he do his Mormon mission at? I'm curious.
In France. So he was like, he was sipping cappuccino and going door to door in Paris while everyone else was dying. And he, that was his excuse.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Newt didn't even have an excuse. Newt's excuse was, I felt I could do more staying here than going there. Newt's excuse was that he'd be worthless on the battlefield. Which, there was a quote, I forget the exact words, but I'll ParrotPhrase it for you. He basically said he wouldn't do much good anyway.
Gingrich did not enlist in the military and was not drafted during Vietnam. He expressed some regret about this decision in 1985, saying, "Given everything I believe in, a large part of me thinks that I should have gone over." You know who was a total draft dodger that now is like Mr. Neocon pro-military? Is Ted Nugent. Ted Nugent bragged in an article in, I believe it was Crawdaddy magazine, which was a 70s rock magazine, bragged that the way he got out of the draft was by, he knew when his medical exam was going to be or about when it was going to be, and he stopped bathing for a month. And then for like 2 weeks, just peed in his pants, didn't change his clothes. And then for the last week, just shit in his pants. He went in, dropped his pants for his medical exam, and they said, "Get the f*** out of here." And he bragged about that, and now he's Mr. I support the troops, USO tour, go USA, bomb the brown people back to the Stone Age, the military is great, I love the Second Amendment, And did you know that Ted Nugent is a cop at some federal level, like a federal deputy or something? Like, he got himself deputized to be a cop so he could conceal carry all around the country.
Why the Doesn't he just
that's square, man.
Shut the fuck up and play Stranglehold? And that's all I need from
you,
Ted.
Just, I know. He hasn't done a good song since then. He has a song about the NRA, and it's a horrible song. And he's on the board.
He's
of the
all
NRA.
On their nuts. He's dick riding. He's dick riding Bush and dick riding Romney. And
I know. But a lot of the times when he speaks, he makes perfect sense. I mean, you know, a stop clock is right. He's right more than twice a day. I mean, he's really, he could run for office and win. Put it that way. He talks a good talk.
Yeah, except when it comes to foreign policy or...
He's pro-war on drugs.
Yeah, exactly.
Because he doesn't do drugs, so he thinks that everyone else should be destroyed if they
right,
do.
Right, right. Which, the basic tenet, again, is freedom is one thing. If you're going to talk a good game about freedom and then promote something like the war on drugs, you're full of shit. You're either ignorant or you're a liar because you don't understand what's going on, or you only care about yourself.
Well, one thing that I want to talk about that really bugs me is the Montana Meth Project. And it shouldn't bother me because it's privately funded, as far as I can tell, funded by donations, voluntarily funded, and it's just public education, basically run by this billionaire who ran for president a few years ago as a Republican and didn't win, you know, which shows you what kind of control freak he is. So he started this organization. I don't know if he had a family member who was a meth addict or what. I don't know what his motivation was, but he decided he was going to clean up the Mountain West. You know, basically it's Montana, Wyoming, a few other states in this part of the country. He targets states with low populations because it's easy to saturate them
with
billboards.
Right. I mean, there's only two TV stations in Wyoming, or three if you count Cheyenne.
Yeah. They do these PSAs and they do these billboards that are basically softcore kiddie pornography. You know, I mean, they've got things like 12-year-old girls in a truck stop bathroom with two 45-year-old creepy guys about to do them for drug money. You know, if you put a picture of that on your front yard without the stop meth text, your neighbors would f***ing lynch you in this town, in this state, in this part of the country, or you'd be arrested. You'd be arrested at worst, or you'd be driven out with pitchforks at best. But since it's for some public good, some demon, you know, meth, people love it. And billboard companies give them deep discount billboard rates, and they put them f***ing everywhere. You know, I think in LibPair, first of all, meth wouldn't be as big of a problem.
You'd have all the coke and weed you could smoke and snort. You would, what the would you want meth for?
And it wouldn't be as prevalent. You know, something I noticed in traveling Europe, in countries like Germany and France, where the drinking age is like as soon as you can hold a bottle, where literally like 15 or 16 year old kids go to a coffee shop after school and have a beer and then go home. There's not the kind of teenage alcoholism there is here where it's forbidden, you know, because it's not at all kept away from them, where in America, you know, the first time kids get their hands on some liquor, they drink so much that they go into a coma or they wrap dad's car around the telephone pole. In Europe, they've been, you know, sipping it since they were kids, and there's not as much teenage alcoholism. There's not as much of a problem when teens drink.
Oh,
there.
Totally. I mean, I remember when I was a freshman in college, and that was our main goal, you know, on Friday, Saturday, hell, every night of the fucking week, was to get some, to hey Mr. Somebody, or to get somebody with a fake ID, or to go use our own fake ID, get our booze, and then just get fucking plastered, piss all over the pool table, or whatever. You know, now that I can buy beer whenever, you know, I buy a six pack and it takes me a week to finish it.
What country was it? Was it Portugal that legalized drugs and drug use?
Decriminalized. It's a very important distinction because
it's still controlled.
Still controlled. It's still controlled, still regulated, but basically they stopped throwing people in jail for possession, which is a good step. I mean, it's a really good step to not throw people in cages just for possessing something. I mean, how anti-free market is that, to throw somebody in jail just because they own a piece of fucking property?
Yeah. I think that the fact that marijuana is so illegal in so much of America really is contributing to the liberty movement, but it requires people like us to give them the final piece of the puzzle. It's like marijuana activists are out in the street protesting, saying, we want marijuana freely available and regulated and taxed like alcohol. And they're getting it in some places. And then someone like us comes over and whispers in their ear, why even put
exactly.
up with that?
Right.
Why shouldn't you just be able to grow as much as you want in your backyard and not have to get a permission slip and pay money
exactly.
to do it?
No, I had a guy. In fact, we have guys all around and girls all around our city here in Washington State. They're in front of Walmart. They're in front of the strip mall. And they say, hey, are you registered to vote? Here, sign this petition to – and they always position it this way – to regulate and tax marijuana like alcohol. And one of them said it to me.
I said,
how about ending the drug war and making it completely legal without regulating and taxing it? And he just looked at me like really confused. And then he goes, well, you know where to get it, right? And I'm like, yeah, I know where to get it. And I just kept walking. And he just didn't know.
Was he offering to sell
me
some?
I don't think he was offering to sell me some, but he was just like, well, you can get it if you want it. And I was like, you know, thinking in my head, yeah, but I'd rather have the convenience, right, of just going up to the fucking corner store. I mean, I can.
You should have pulled out your gun and started rapping one of the songs from the movie for him. Freedom of ingestion.
Right, right.
Hello, freedom fiends. It's your boy, Dean, from the U.S. Get the U.S. out my bloodstream. Ask permission and I won't say please. Freedom fans, one fact that I gotta make clear is, if it ain't about your heater, then you're nothing but a theorist. You can read it tight, but when the jack is coming, I know you'll lose the fight on your ass with your thumb in.
Good morning, Senator. Here's your coffee.
Thanks, I'll need it. I have so many laws to write before November.
I'm so excited.
You should be. Slim majority lets me tell everyone what to do.
Freedom of ingestion, it's more than a suggestion. And no, it ain't a question, but them hoes just keep oppressing. And so we teaching lessons for those with chief in sessions and those with Smith and Wessons. Freedom is possession.
Nah, he would have ran off and pissed his pants.
I know. Well, I think I would notice and be on high alert if I were talking to anybody and they pulled out a gun.
Yeah, yeah. Not a good thing to do. Brandishing, not a good idea unless it's necessary.
Yeah. Yeah. Unless it's to get them, you know, that label to sign your band, so.
Right, right. Pull a Suge Knight. You know how it goes.
Yeah. Hey, we don't need the Muslims and Suge Knight after us. I'm going to beep that name.
We're just making all sorts of enemies. I don't know. We're going to get droned, drive-by'd, and suicide-bombed at the same time. We're going to get our own Wikipedia entry just because of that.
Yep, they're going to be fighting over it. Like, who gets to hold up our severed head in the YouTube video? Yeah.
Yeah.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
Yeah, so the Montana Meth Project.
Right. Back to that.
See, since I don't smoke pot, I can come back to the thing like that. That's one thing that I couldn't do when I was doing a lot of drugs. I think they're just a jobs program because they, like, the lady that runs the Montana Meth Project in Montana, you know, the state head of it there, she makes like $126,000 a year working for a nonprofit in a state with like no people.
Wow. That's like public school superintendent money right there.
I know. And they hire these, San Francisco and Madison Avenue, New York, like high-dollar advertising companies. And, you know, the first ads they did were directed by Darren Aronofsky, mm-hmm. and they looked like Requiem for a Dream. Yeah. And then they just got sick of paying him and just hired some nobody, to, like, copy his look. It was really cheesy.
Yeah.
Even the billboards still look like... And, you know, I wonder if there's, like... I mean, they do these studies that they pay for, and they claim that meth use is down because of them, which I really have a lot of questions about. First of all, it's like they're paying for them. And secondly, I just don't believe it. I think that there must be, like, a Go Ask Alice effect to it, because it's like... You know, as horrible as they make meth use look in these, they use these really pretty actors in them. They make it look kind of glamorous, you know. They don't use, like, fat, toothless Wyomingites or anything. They use these sexy, skinny hipsters.
Right, right. The thing that bugs me is who the enemy is, right? I mean, meth use, yeah, it does cause problems. It's a pretty horrible thing. But who's the real culprit? The culprit isn't an inanimate f***ing object. The culprit is the drug war. The culprit is the government who makes meth use and the cooking of meth economically profitable to people.
How much resistance do you think you'd face, and what kind of resistance do you think you'd face if you were a billionaire and started an aggressive advertising campaign of the type of the Montana Meth Project, with billboards and TV and print ads and going in, you know, well, you couldn't get into schools, but if you started doing a libertarian campaign
against
like that,
the
drug war, where you showed like goons shooting grandma or something, like, which is as graphic as their stuff is. They've got teenagers beating up grandpa for his money. What if you had ads with cops shooting grandma that had some text of like, you know, this is what the drug war leads to, grandma being killed for being next door to the wrong house.
No, that's a great idea. Yeah, I was kind of mulling that over when you were talking about the Montana Meth Project. We need something like that. We need a, and I don't even think we need a libertarian billionaire to front that. Although, if you want to front it, front it. But we could why don't we do some shit like that?
Yeah, well, I don't really have the Photoshop skills to do it, but if someone does, you know, there's the first poster right there. Make it. We'll get it out there.
Mm-hmm.
I have a picture. I might use this for the picture for this episode, although it doesn't really match the title of Old Man Kills Playful Young Boys. It's a takeoff on the Montana Meth Project ones. You know, they say meth, not even once. It says, talk to your cat about catnip, and it says catnip, not even once. And it's got this Photoshop picture of a cat smoking a joint, and they're like down in some hole, like a sub-basement, looking out, and one of the cats is like the lookout. He's looking up at the street to see if anyone's going to catch him.
Nice, yes. We need a libertarian war on the war on drugs. Just like we needed to banning. We need a war on the war on drugs.
I'm going to say that in the show notes, that we call for a war on the war, an advertising war on the war on drugs.
Exactly. Because like we said earlier in the cast, the war on drugs is a war on people. So we need to defend people from the war on themselves.
You know, I just wonder if you got really successful at that, if they would like sneak in your house and plant a kilo of coke and then bust you for it on an anonymous tip or something.
Probably, but we already took care of that problem with our Don't Drone Me Bro episode.
Yep. So in the few minutes we have left here, I wanted you to read this part from the intro of the book Steal This Book, which was a big influence on me as a kid. And there are differences between Abbie Hoffman and us. You know, he was a socialist. He wanted a stateless society where everybody owned everyone's property. And he was violent, which we are not. But I like his writing. So go ahead and read this intro.
It's perhaps fitting that I write this introduction in jail, that graduate school of survival. Here you learn how to use toothpaste as glue, fashion a shiv out of a spoon, and build intricate communication networks. Here, too, you learn the only rehabilitation possible, hatred of oppression. Steal This Book is, in a way, a manual of survival in the prison that is America.
And it's America with a K.
It preaches jailbreak. The duty of a revolutionary is to make love, and that means staying alive and free. That doesn't allow for cop-outs. Smoking dope and hanging up Shay's picture is no more a commitment than drinking milk and collecting postage stamps. A revolution in consciousness is an empty high without a revolution in the distribution of power. We are not interested in the greening of America, except for the grass that will cover its grave. We cannot survive without learning to fight, and that is the lesson in the second section. Fight separates revolutionaries from outlaws. The purpose of part two is not to f*** the system, but to destroy it. The weapons are carefully chosen. They are homemade, in that they are designed for use in our unique electronic jungle. Here, the Uptown Reviewer will find ample proof of our violent nature. But again, the dictionary of law fails us. Murder in uniform is heroic. In a costume, it is a crime. When we conclude that bank robbers rather than bankers should be the trustees of the universities, then we begin to think clearly. When we see the Army Mathematics Research and Development Center and the Bank of America as cesspools of violence filling the minds of our young. December 1970, Cook County Jail, Chicago. Free speech is the right to shout theater in a crowded fire.
I like it. It's interesting, too. It's like still kind of timely. I mean, Bank of America is still the enemy to a lot of people.
And I wonder if that he means more than just the corporate entity of Bank of America. I wonder if he really means the whole banking system.
Well, yeah, but the corporate entity Bank of America existed in 1970. Ah,
yes.
Let's see, I'm reading the description of Steal This Book on Wikipedia. The book includes advice on such topics as growing cannabis, starting a pirate radio station, living in a commune, stealing food, shoplifting, stealing credit cards, preparing a legal defense, making pipe bombs, and obtaining a free buffalo from the Department of the Interior.
A free buffalo, huh?
Yep. And there's, you know, a few things there we don't condone, like making bombs and stealing.
Right.
Yeah. But the book advocates rebelling against authority in all forms, government and corporate.
If only these people had the non-aggression principle, then they would just make that leap and everything would be right.
Yeah, and the difference is, and this is the next line in the Wikipedia article, Hoffman referred to America as the pig empire and stated that it was not immoral to steal from it. In fact, he wrote that it was immoral not to do so, which I disagree with. You know, I don't think stealing's right.
What about stealing from a thief? Stealing back your item. You're stealing back what was stolen from you. Is that moral?
Sure. But, you know, that gets into, what are you talking about? Like kicking in the door of the guy that steals your weed and putting a gun to his head and taking it? I don't put myself in a position where I'd have to do that.
But, exactly.
People do that, and it's a weird gray area.
And I think that that's where he was confused, is I think he felt like America was stealing from him, and so his defense was to steal from America. The problem is, yeah, is collectivism on both fronts. He thought of the people, or the we the people, as the collective that America was stealing from, and America as this vague collective that he could steal from. But what we need to break down is not only do we need the non-aggression principle, but we need to view everybody as an individual. Everybody
right.
is just an individual. The state is nothing but a myth. It's a mythology.
You know, I think in a lot of ways, the movie Fight Club and the book Fight Club are kind of the spiritual stepchildren of Steal This Book.
I could see that. Yeah, I could see that. And, yeah, and their goal in Fight Club was, of course, to destroy all the
Credit card companies.
Right, right. So that all everything would start from zero. The fresh start, basically.
Which wouldn't really work because they don't just have the computers in one building.
Right, right.
They have them backed up in a cloud. All right, man. I think that's at the end of our point here, and we will drift off into the cloud of liberty for another week. You're going to have an interview coming up, though, on Monday. With who?
James Davis. He is a big
alternative education
big proponent,
guy, really.
More of a how-to rather than a theorist. He's actually got
he does it.
He talks the talk. So we're gonna talk the talk with him and see what you can do. News you can use, basically, on how to raise your child as a liberty lover.
Yep. And there's not going to be an SEO episode this week. There will be next week. And there will be the usual Sunday user's manual for the human experience. So lots of freedom coming your
way.
Oh,
yeah. Peace.
Worms.
Hello, freedom fiends. It's your boy, Bean, from the U.S. Get the U.S. out my bloodstream. I owe me and that includes endorphins. No one won't ask permission and I won't say please. Freedom fans, one fact that I gotta make clear.
The Freedom Fiends podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution Share-alike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around. Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Every week, we'll have an exciting new episode where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi weave their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it. Available from freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFiends.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them.